How many people like tax-free income? Okay, because I just said taxes is a big reason that the rich are richer and the poor are poorer, right? Because they don't pay attention to that, and they don't teach you that, even in the Ivy League schools. I even had an economic question that said, if you disregarded taxes, what's the answer? The answer is definitely different if you can disregard taxes, but where can you disregard taxes? No place that I know of in the United States. Yeah. You probably can, right? If you're one of those few. We don't provide any investment advice, and we don't endorse any investments. All information that I'm giving you here today is from publication 590 and 560. It is for you guys to learn and research, and I encourage you to bring your accountants, your financial advisors, your spouses, whoever you use, into look at CamaPlan. And any investment, I want you to do your due diligence on. And any company you work with, do your due diligence on. I don't want anybody just coming and buying an investment without doing their due diligence. I have a couple of stories where people said, well, it was my husband's roommate from college, and then she gets divorced, and she says, well, I don't know where he is. I don't know where his address is. I can't find my investment. I think it was a scam, my husband and he was in. And I said, well, why are you doing your due diligence now? She says, I'm trying to get my money back. You know, so do your due diligence on companies ahead of time. Right? That's a really big lesson that you need to learn. A little bit about me, because I'm going to ask you guys some questions. Fair? I'll answer any questions you want. You want my Social Security number, I'll give it to you. I don't, you know, really, I'll tell you anything I know. I grew up in Fort Lauderdale, although I was born across the river in Montclair, New Jersey. I went to Jersey, exactly. I went to Cornell University after my mom and dad moved to Fort Lauderdale. What a mistake, right? You go from sun down there every day to gray days, you know, and they have more gray days than here. After I graduated, I went to Kennedy Space Center, and I worked on the shuttle program and a couple of secret programs on the Titan Air Force side of the plan. And I learned about self-directing because I invested in real estate. My mom and dad were in real estate. Their mom and dads were in real estate. So that's why I was a third generation real estate. And when I could find out I could do real estate and collect rents tax-free, I couldn't believe it, right? Too good to be true. How come my dad and mom didn't tell me about this? Because it was a secret. It was only a secret out there for the wealthy, right? And I didn't learn about it until 1995, but you could have been doing it in the late 70s. So that really made me get into the business. Once I got into the business, you know, other people were asking me about it, and then finally, when I say into the business, I started investing that way, and then people talked me into doing the company because I was helping them out. So I've been in real estate the whole time. I still own rental property. I do private lending. I do tax liens. I don't do a lot of, you know, what Phil and Larry do on the options trading. I have a policy like Brent and Chris Noggle have. I don't like paying taxes. I've been married a long time to my wife. I got four boys and I got six grandkids. That slide should have been updated. Am I biased? You think everybody in this room is biased? Because you grow up in knowing certain things, right? The Bible says everybody's given different gifts, right? Tax-free, I'm biased towards, okay? And real estate I'm biased towards because I grew up around it, right? I feel like my dad could have been rich dad, poor dad. I didn't know why people rented. He didn't know why people bought houses, right? So when I'm talking today, you're going to see this come out, and I just want to warn you that about that ahead of time. All right, so now I'm going to did I answer enough about me? You guys didn't come here, and you're not going to make any money knowing about me either, right? But How many people in here have a job? Okay, a lot of you. How many people in here pay income taxes? What do you know? Only 50% of the United States pays income taxes? Yeah, well, that puts you up in that level where it is, but you know, just so you know that. And what they do to get income taxes and to get them passed, you know, there's a new tax out there. Like if you make $500 million, they're going to give you, you know, they're going to be taxed at another 1%. So they get everybody to vote. I'm never going to make $500 million a year, right? So that's what they do. And that's how income tax came around, right? They said, oh, we're going to give it to everybody that's making over $10,000 back in 1913 or something. And everybody voted for it because they didn't make it, right? And it was only 7%. Now 50% of Americans are paying taxes. So whenever they say they're going to pay a tax, they're always going to change the number, bring it down, and raise the interest rate. And I don't know if that's always, but that's what they've done over the past 100 years. How many people in here own your own company? That's a pretty nice tax write-off, right? You can work the books a little bit there. How many people in here have a retirement plan? How many of them have a self-directed retirement plan? A little bit less, but congratulations. How many of them are with CAMA plan? Those of you that aren't, stop listening. Oh, no, I'm only kidding you, right? What?
The ones in orange.
All right, everybody who has a CAMA plan, raise your hand.
Look at the hand.
Okay.
Oh, right? Yeah. And again, I don't get anything off of Carl, you know. In fact, we should, right?
Yeah. I didn't charge you to come here today, right? You didn't even pick up my plane ticket, right? Right. Is your business a hobby, or is it there to make money? Okay, good. A lot of people go into business and it's a hobby to them. How many people have all the money you need? No, some of you do, and you're just being modest, right? Okay. A plan to attain what you want. How many people have that? Okay. You need that plan. You need to write it down. Okay. The fact that you're here is good and it's a good start, but you got to have concrete steps that you can put down and put it to where you want. So what, and I can't go through the whole room, but what's your specific objective for being here today and maybe even listening to me? What do you want from it? Money, raise your knowledge, financial freedom, self-directed IRAs. That's real easy. Go to our website, open one up. You can go to Larry's, and I think, Larry, do you have a place to open up accounts on your website for us?
We did, and we have to redo it.
The answer is no. All right, go to camaplan.com, and it'll make it easy, right? But that's one of the steps. You want to know what you're going to do every day towards your plan. And if you have a plan, even if it's a lousy plan and it's poorly executed, you'll be way better than people who have no plan, right? And are just kind of going through haphazardly. Look at all these things up here. That's your biggest expense. It's not your spouse when you got divorced. It's not your car. It's not your house. These things here take your money. All right, and I love Chris and Brent's presentation, and they're talking to you about putting interest on your side, but you've also got to do taxes. You can't fix all of these because they're a pain in the neck, but one of the biggest ones, and what's your name?
Marmonito.
And what do you go by? Marmonito.
That's it.
Yeah. If she says it again, it ain't going to help.
How about you say Ramona?
Ramona, okay. Or Romanita?
Yeah.
That's pretty good. Okay, good. All right, so Romanita, you know, she didn't like paying the income taxes, but in most cases, that's where a lot of it is. It's a big chunk. If you can cut some of that down between state, federal, and local, you're doing pretty good. Right? And it's not how much you make, but how much you get to keep. Right? So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about saving tax, and I'm going to talk to you about difference in money. Right? And I'm not talking about, you know, the British pound or the euro or the yen on that. Right? Here's some tax avoidance tools that are in there. Marital deduction. How many people in here got married for their deduction?
Teaching me something new. Yeah. Maybe I should go get married tomorrow.
Yeah. I would not do that. Okay. How many people in here had kids for a deduction?
No way.
Yeah. And that was before that push gift deal, right? You know, thank God I didn't see that, right? But I did learn something. Right? How much you think you spend on your kids versus how much the government gives you back for them?
Too much.
Yeah, exactly. Right? Here's a quick story, right? We're going to my granddaughter's birthday, and my wife says to us, and it's like 2 weeks beforehand, I'm not going to get her all the gifts. We're just going to give her a gift card, you know, so she can buy what she wants. And then we don't have to carry all that stuff, and she doesn't have to put it down in the basement with all her other toys. And I said, I like that idea, right? So 2 weeks come, you know, and my wife says, can you go in there and grab those two bags? And she's got two bags, right? Her arm's full. And I said, what's all this? She says, Kaylee's toys. I said, what happened to the gift card? And she says, well, I got that too. You know? So I don't know what to do when your wife says that to you, you know?
Listen.
You go with the flow. Keep your mouth shut. Pull your mask up so she can't see your face, right? And go with the flow, right? So all of these things you can use, right? And they have different ones. Business deductions are good. 1031 exchanges are good. The life insurance, you saw how that to use the interest with you. And all that money when you die, that's your exit strategy, is tax-free. I don't like that strategy, by the way. But if you are going to die. I'm full of good news today. Right? Tax-free and tax-deferred plans. That's what we're going to talk a little bit about today, right? How many people in here know what a self-directed IRA is? Okay, a few of you. Well, this is the definition I had about 15 years ago before it was in Wikipedia, right? They didn't have it in Wikipedia at that point in time. Say it again. You don't know what that means. Well, let me just keep it simple. You get to invest in anything you want, okay, except for a couple things. And I'll tell you what those are. And it's not what they end up selling. But if you want a better definition, go to Wikipedia. It's got a really good 1.5-page definition of this, if you need more words. Tax the seeds, not the crops. This is some of the stuff Brent went over, right? He talked about taxes going up. Kennedy, Reagan, Obama, Trump. Anybody know what the maximum tax rate was in my lifetime? 90%. Anybody know what the lowest was in my lifetime? 18, no. Close, though. 28%, right? Kennedy had it at 90%. And Reagan brought it down to 28%. How many knows what the maximum tax rate is now? 37.5, plus you get another 2% for hitting that range. So it's around 30. Well, yeah, but Phil, the other thing that happened, though, is Kennedy was a Democrat, and when he got office, it was 90%. He dropped them down to 72, okay? So things have changed over the years, right? You heard be the bank, right, from him. That's a great idea, right? Deductible and non-deductible interest. He talks about, you know, doing that, and he talks about the company being able to save that. But on the other side, that money's going to you, and you're going to pay the taxes on that. In that scenario, it's still good. You know, I don't want to take anything away from it. Right, borrow lower, lend higher. Right, the tax bite. Adapt versus set it and forget it. So yeah, you have to stay on top of this. And I don't care, no matter what you are, you can't make a plan, you know, in 2000 and expect it still to be the same thing in 2020, because technology changes, the laws change, your circumstances change. So you have to at least dress it once a year. That's all. You know, take 4 or 6 hours once a year and adjust your plan based on it. And your accountant or your attorney or whoever your advisor is should be able to help you do that, right? And this is kind of to help you get a plan. So am I making sense, giving you certain steps? These aren't steps that are too hard, because life rewards action, and you have to make a decision to do stuff tomorrow. And some of you are already going to jump and go buy a couple of life insurance policies for yourself and your kids, et cetera. But make sure you have a plan. Maybe you do that and you buy one every year, but you want to look at the full thing and develop your plan and see where and when you want to implement these types of things. What does CAMA plan do? Basically, the IRS requires you to have somebody hold your money. They don't trust you. It's like, you know, they think that it's letting a hungry man hold a sandwich. And they made the law around it, right? So sounds like you might have been hungry there, huh? Hungry woman hold the sandwich up here in the front, right? All right. So they make somebody hold it that's going to keep the records and pay attention and not let you get out of it from that thing. We're a neutral third party. We do not sell any investments. We don't endorse any investments. We're never going to come with that deal. We let you, self-directed, find out what you want to invest in. Why do I invest in real estate, do you think? Because I told you my mom and dad were in it, and their moms and dads were in it, and I grew up around it, and I like it, and I know it, and I understand the risks associated with it, right? Phil with his stock options, that was a killer to me, right? I do not want to get up at 6 o'clock in the morning and turn on the TV, right? I'm not doing that. If I'm up at 6 o'clock, I'm loading bait and ice in the boat, right? And, you know, so, you know, now I might give my money not to Phil because, you know, or his brother, I think I'll give it to Larry, but, right? But, you know, because he doesn't like the puts. And I got to play the market both ways in my thing. But I don't want to really do that. It's not me. I want to deal with my life, you know, and the things that I want to do with it. And I'll take a few less percentage points if he's making 541%, like the gentleman over here figured out earlier, right? If I can make 500%, that's good enough. And then Phil gets up at 6 in the morning and does the deal, right? So that's kind of where we are. But when you buy these assets, you know, we'll do the reporting just like Fidelity, Vanguard, Merrill Lynch, TD does, so that you can buy things that you know and understand and have less risk on. Does that make sense? Right? Because what do you think most people buy with Fidelity and Vanguard? Index funds, stocks, and bonds, right? Do they all have self-directed plans? Oh, they do. You call them up and ask them, right? You know, yeah, you can have a self-directed plan, and you can buy from anything we sell. Here's your menu, right? And it's index funds, stocks, bonds, you know, options, et cetera. We don't tell you that. You can buy real estate, notes, private lending, gold, silver, private companies, et cetera. So that's the difference between our company and Fidelity and Vanguard self-directed plans. But now, should you have one of these plans? Look around to the people that all have retirement plans. Why do you have them? Because if you open up this account and you do this investing, right? And if you're good at stocks and bonds, it's great. If you're good at real estate, it's good. But if you put money in this account, and this was $16,000 that was put into, sorry about that, guys. $16,000 that was put into this account 40 years later because they were able not to pay taxes on the earnings, and they were able to reinvest it like you heard people talking about. The same as $16,000 is worth $300,000 here and $1 million there. Just by opening an account, right? Spending $50 opening up the account, you know, earlier. Is that pretty simple? And then doing the exact same investing. Because of the taxes, that's the difference that you're making. Nobody told you this in school, right? They don't show it to you, but you can go to your own financial advisor and ask them to show you something that gives you this, and they'll have that. So what would happen today if this was a traditional IRA versus a Roth and you wanted to take your money out? How much would you get taxed? I just told you that it's 39%. If you took out the whole million, you would take $390,000 off of this. But guess what? If you took $390,000 off of this, you'd still be at $600,000, right? Double that. So it's good to have those traditional IRAs as well. I like the Roth because I told you I'm biased towards the tax-free, and I'd rather pay the tax on $6,000 today instead of $600,000 in the future because we think taxes are going up. All right, let's talk about the different types of money. How many people in here have a job? How many people get a W-2? How many people get a 1099? Okay, you fall in this top category pretty much, okay? How many people in here that have a job have ever asked for a raise? Really? The rest of you are happy with it or what? Yeah. What? You asked for it, but didn't mean anything? Okay.
Exactly.
Who came in and asked for it with you when you got the raise? You know? Did Biden or Trump come in with you? No? What? No, I'm saying, did he go into the office with your boss and say, hey, he wants a raise? No? How about Wolf? Is it Wolf? How about Wolf? Did he come in? He didn't come in, right? How about the local commission? Were they backing you when you went in for that raise? Any doctors or Social Security, Medicare people come with you? They didn't, did they? But if you got that raise, right away, they get a raise because you went in and did it, right? Fed is up to 39%, state is up to 10%. Somebody told me that one state's going up from 6 to 8% out here earlier. Local taxes go up to 4%. Depends on which state you're in and where it is, right? Social Security and Medicare is 7.6, and if you've got your own company, it's 15. Okay? So that money just disappears from your paycheck, even though you're the one who went in there, combed your hair, brushed your teeth, and sweat talking to your boss about getting a, you know, a dollar an hour raise for the extra work that they gave you, right? So out of this $100,000 that you make because all these people are sucking off of you, right, you end up keeping, let's say, $60,000. If you don't believe me, look at your pay stubs, right, at the end of the year and see it. So that's kind of what I call the worst type of money. But that's the type of money that everybody is thinking about and they're worrying about making. So I'm going to try to have you change, right? Screech on the brakes and watch this, right? You're going into rental property, right? And you make $100,000 in rental property. How much do you save right there? Because of the laws, Social Security and Medicare go right off. So just 15% you save right off the top. So where you were making $60,000, you're now making $75,000, right? And I'm not even taking into account the depreciation, et cetera. It's actually a little better than that. Have you ever thought about that? right? And that's things like rents, royalties, capital gains are in those kind of categories. Think about where you're going to now spend your time making that money, right? Forget about thinking about talking to your boss because I think what's your name? Yeah, Harry already said yeah, I asked, but he didn't give it to me. So why waste the time, right? So the next one is tax deferred, like self-directed IRAs, etc. If you make that $100,000, it goes into your account at $100,000. And that's great, and you can invest it, and you can make more money on it as time goes on, right? But when you turn 72 years old, the government says, well, we've been kind of partners all this time. We haven't taxed you on any of this money, but now we want you to start pulling it out, okay? And you have to take this amount, and we're going to tax you this amount. I wouldn't even make that deal with my wife, right? Give them complete control over your money. But that's basically where you are with the tax deferred accounts. So you get to pull out $100,000, but like on the example beforehand, we said this goes down to $700,000 or $600,000, right? But you could pull out a little bit at a time maybe and get it, you know, 15, 20, 30%. It doesn't really matter. Is this making sense? Anybody ever tell you this? No? Okay, so this is you need to understand this when you're making money, right? And then the fourth category I put it in is the tax-free or the Roth type of accounts or the HSAs or the educational savings accounts. If you make $100,000, it goes into that account at $100,000 and you pull out $100,000. How much tax do you pay on that? Zero, because you paid the tax on the money going in, right? You already paid that. Yeah.
I tried in 2008 when the market went all the way down. I tried with my financial guy when the market went way down and everything was down and my stocks and everything to get into a Roth, okay? And Mr. Kennedy, Jack Kennedy, told me in Woodbury that, oh, well, the government, the politicians, they'll come up with something else to change on the Roth, so you're better off to stay right where you are.
Well,
you know,
all right, they have come up.
Yeah, and I figure he did my wife and I wrong.
Well, I think you were wrong, too. I think you should have done it, yeah. Right? There's a lot of reasons for that. A lot of the smart people have done it, and the very smart people were doing it previous to that and paying the taxes. Because everything you earn on that money, and when it comes back, you've already paid taxes. You know, in 2008, it went down 50%. So you paid taxes on 50% of it, and now, you know, and that was like, you know, 15,000. Now it's up to 30,000. So you'd have a lot more money had your financial advisor not told you that. Now they did make a change, right? You used to be able to take a Roth, and I could give it to my kid, and he could give it to his kid, and my plan was to have it go out a century. All right, but they just wrote that down and at the end of 2019, right before COVID, that you can only use these accounts tax-free for 10 years after you die. So if my kids get this or my grandkids get it, they're only going to get it for 10 years. And then they're going to have to take that money out. It's going to go back into the taxable income in the place, and that's it. But obviously they can always make changes. I still think it's a good time to look at converting to Roth. They're still good. And if they were going to change those rules on the Roth, and I'm guessing you're over 59 and a half, if they're going to change those and you're over 59 and a half or close to that, you always get warning on you know, that they're going to change this. And if they're going to change it and they're going to say, you know, kind of screw you because they love to screw the baby boom generation, take your money out and go wherever you want with it at that point before they put the new laws into effect. There's always things like that. Obviously, I'm looking at it for myself, you know, and my sister's, you know, 15 years younger. So we have people that are looking at this and accountants and pretty good people on what's going to happen when things change. And you'll come up with strategies. We're a lot smarter than the government, and we can pivot much faster than, you know, the federal or state governments. Yeah, but it doesn't matter. You figure it out. You figure out a way, right? Everybody's starting to learn now that you know, society, college, the whole thing. When you go to kindergarten at 8 o'clock in the morning, you get off at 12, that's just indoctrinating you to go to work at 8, you know, have lunch at 12, and then work from 12 to 4. You know, even the way Phil was talking about the brokers, right? So you're indoctrinated to get a job when you go out, right? That's what they talk about, right up through college, et cetera. Nobody really talks about entrepreneurial working. So you do have to change your mind. The young people in here have to think about that. But the other one is not everybody has the skill set to be entrepreneurs. And there are places for people that, you know, just do one job and get paid for it and they like it. And they don't have to worry about things when they go home. But that's another class, you know, running your own business versus having a job, right? And let me just put this other wisdom out there that, you know, from my age that I found is, I don't want to live my life for money. I want to plan my life and then have the money figure out in that plan so that I can do what I want to do, right? I want to fish and I want Phil making that money for me at 6 o'clock in the morning. And when I roll that fish in, you know, and he runs back at 3:20 to finish off his things, you know. I'm filleting the fish, right? Thinking about dinner. All right. Since Phil's always picking on Colin, we give him a little back, right? All right, so does this make sense to you up here? What type of money do you think, if you got up in the morning and you wanted and you had money in each one of these accounts, which one would you start working first? The tax-free account. Make sure that money's working good, right? Then go to the next level here, and then go to this one, and then finally go to your job. And who cares if you get fired if you got money coming in all these three? All right. Why do you think this works for investors, self-directed IRAs? Choices. They control their money. You don't have to pay capital gains. You don't have to pay a lot of taxes, right? Tax-free income for life. How many people like tangible assets? Okay. How many people had Wachovia stock back in 2008? All right. Was worth $34 on Friday and 10 cents on Monday. I've never seen that with a piece of land. Even after it burns down, right, or goes into a sinkhole, you at least get the insurance, or somebody puts up a help me page or something and gets you some money, right? So this is the reason that it works. Let me ask you, how many people know the difference between a Roth and a traditional? Not that many. Why do you think there's more money in traditional accounts than Roth accounts? What? Marketing? How many people in here are greedy? Oh, bullshit. All right. Here's what happens, okay? You go in to pick up your taxes or you get a phone call from your accountant. And he says, if you put, you know, $6,000 in the in your IRA account, in your traditional IRA account, I'm going to get you a $2,000 check back. If you don't, you're not getting anything back. What do? You go put the $6,000 in your traditional IRA so that you can get a check for $2,000. You say, well, it's still in my account. It still says $6,000, and now I'm getting $2,000 that I can go spend on something else or cover it from that. You understand what I'm saying? Okay. How many? Who in here has $80 on them? How many of you out of that, with that $80, would like to buy a $100 bill for that $80? What? Pull it out. What? Dan's coming up. No, I'm going to give it to Scott since he sat up front. Huh? I hope I have. Is that a real 100? I don't know about you. I'm going to let her have that one.
I'll take 100. You ain't trust me? That's all right.
No, just the way you grabbed that was.
I said, let me check it out.
All right. It's real. Check it out now. All righty. There's $80. Is that a good deal? How many times would you do that deal? That's why.
Every day.
Right. That's why the government puts a limit on how much you can put in. Okay? And that's in a traditional IRA. But guess what? Every bit of that money, including that 100, that you have in your account and you keep working it, and it turns up to 1,000, 10,000, 100,000, you and I are going to split some of that. You're going to pay taxes back to me on that money. Right? So that's the traditional account. Now, if I gave you $100 for $100, how many people would do that?
No.
But if you put it into that Roth account instead of the traditional account, everything you make on that $100 is yours to keep with no taxes. Right? So if you buy a rental property, it's tax-free. If you lend that out to somebody and you make 12 or 15% based on the points and the interest rates that was talked about today, that's all tax-free. All right, so that's the difference between a Roth and a traditional. Any accountants in here? I wish there was, but all accountants, I think they must go to a school, but they always say, never pay your taxes up front. Defer it and defer it and defer it as long as you can. I don't subscribe to that. I want to pay the taxes when it's low and I know what they are and I don't have to worry about where they're going in the future. So that should be one of the questions you have on your, when you're putting up and making your plan. All right, ask yourself, do I want to have a Roth or not? When the Roths came out back in the 90s, I didn't even understand them. But I did know that when Washington passes laws, that I usually got screwed. So I split my money. I said, I'm only going to let them get me for half of it this time. So I split my money between the Roth and the traditional. And of course, once I had one, I learned about it. And it took me a while to believe it. And I still have clients that say, are you sure I don't have to pay taxes on that? Yep, right today, you do not have to pay taxes on it. And you don't have to take RMDs. And it's a special plan. So I really think that you guys should at least be considering having Roths. Understand that your accountants are going to be against it. We've been preaching the Roth since we started our business in the early 2000s. And I still think today they're still a good thing and you should be looking to get to them. All right? And somebody said, oh, you're pushing Roths. Your company gets paid more for Roths than traditionals. We don't. It's the same exact pricing for any type of IRA that you have there. And it's all depending on what you're doing. So in this case, if you put that 100 into your traditional account, you basically could do it for $80. If you put it into your Roth account, you'd spend the whole $100 and you'd pay the taxes on it. And that's if you're in a 20% bracket. If he's in a 40% bracket, then obviously he would have, I would have sold him the $100 for $60. Right? So you have to understand, how many people know what tax bracket they're in? All right, put that on your plan. Find out what tax bracket you're in. Right? That's one thing, and think about it, and I'll show you some slides on it here in a little bit. Right? How does it work? We can go through all these steps. It's really, you open up an account. It's just like opening up a bank account, and you put money in it. How do you put money in it? You roll it over from another IRA. You can take an old 401k and put money into it, or you can do the old-fashioned contribution. If you guys want these slides, talk to Larry, and he may give them to you. If you otherwise, take pictures. I don't care. Right. Then you choose your investment. You write the paper out, and now your IRA is buying that investment. Just like it would buy an index fund, it might be buying a house. Or it might be giving a loan on a house, or it might be buying a piece of gold. So it's the same thing as buying an index fund, but now you get to buy what you're good at. Right? Camaplan signs the paperwork, and it's going to say, who owns that property? Camaplan, for the benefit of Ramona Nita. IRA. Okay? And then you'll go online and you'll see that. If it's a note, you'll see that there's a note in there and you'll see the interest come in every month. If it's a house, then you'll see the rent come in every month and you'll just be able to go online and they'll mail it right to your account. And it's just like a dividend or an interest payment from a stock or a bond. Does it make sense? Okay. How many people in here want more money? Okay. Anybody ever know how to do syndications? Dan's got his hand up back there. He'll help you figure that out or get an attorney that'll do that. But that's when you want to borrow, you know, millions of dollars, put them together and buy like an apartment building. So there might be, you know, 20 or 30 of you or 50 or 100 of you that want to get together and buy a 300 unit apartment building. And then you would put a syndication and your IRAs can go into that as well. Right, and we'll help people go into here. Now, how many people believe what I said? Okay, about 25%. The rest of you think I'm a liar. get your experts over here, okay? Tell them what I told you today. Publication 590, 560, we'll do it. We'll get on conversations if they have questions. We'll have a conference call or a Zoom call nowadays, the excellence in the old conference calls. But you have to put your makeup on and you have to wear your clothes. So yeah. All right, now we're there, right? But here's what they're going to say to you, right? And this is some CPAs, some financial advisors, even some attorneys, is that it's not legal. Trust me, it's legal. It's in, you know, Fortune magazine does a lot of them, publications, IRS forms, all of it. We can dispel that very quickly. How many people think real estate's risky? Okay. How many people think stock market's risky? How many people think a business is risky? Yeah, they all have risk, right? But whether your money's in a self-directed account or in a brokerage house account, you know, I think the brokerage house has more risk than us because we put all your money in a government-secured FDIC-insured account, right? So the risk isn't in where it is, it's what you put it in. How many people think real estate's more risky than the stock market? How many people think it's less? I didn't see Phil raise his hand, so I'm wondering which way he's going to go. He does both, right?
I'm not saying shit, but he's
not picking up. It was that easy to shut Phil Falcone up, right? Yeah. I don't believe that for a minute. I'll kill Superman if that's the case next. Right? So the risk is what you invest in. It's not where you have that money. And is it very complex? I don't know. Fold your arms. Real quick. I'm not making you get up and run. Just fold your arms. Right? If you fold your arms, all right, now fold them the other way. You had to think a little bit about that one, right? But once you do it and it's there, it's a little bit like riding a bike, et cetera. It's not complex. And guess what? We're going to be there to help you through all the paperwork and the nuances of doing that. That makes sense, right? So that's what you're going to have when you say, hey, I want to have one of these self-directed IRAs. And I really want you all to have one, even if you don't know what you're going to do with it. And if you're not sure, I really want you to open up a Roth account. How much am I doing good on time? Or am I running out? 10 minutes. All right. Here's all the stuff you can invest in, right? Real estate. I don't care if it's land, apartment buildings, private homes, fourplexes, it doesn't matter. Precious metals, notes, mortgage, private placements, that's trusts, LLCs, limited partnerships, all those types of things, right? Private lending, right? Why do people do it? Real estate backed, known results, right? You're in control. Do you like that? How many people in here do private lending? No, I thought there was more by some of the conversations. All righty. Any of you that need money, look around. No. All right, so let's go over the different types of accounts, right? I already talked about the Roth and the traditional. The SEP and the simple are business accounts, and these are spousal and custodial, so your kids and your wife can have money as long as they have earned income. And if your spouse doesn't have earned income and you do, she or he can also have an account, right? These are business accounts here, and you can put more money into these than you can into the Roth and traditionals. These are 401k plans. You have both the pre and the post-tax. I love the post-tax. There is no income limitations on this. So you can put basically up to $57,000, I think, this year in a 401k, and you can convert all of that to a Roth if you want. Plus, you can put money into a Roth IRA, so you can put almost $63,000 into an account if you have that money, right? Otherwise, you can figure out. People say, well, which one's the best ones? Have as many as you can, right? Because more is better here. Right, these accounts over here, health savings, how many people pay for their own health insurance? Look at HSAs, high deductible health insurance. Those are the best things going because the money going into them is tax deductible, and when that comes out, it's tax free. That's the best, right? You get a deduction when you put it in. Remember over here, when you put it in the Roth, no deduction. You only get the deduction for the traditional. Over here, you put it in your health savings account, you get the deduction, and when you pull it out for medical expenses, you get the, it's tax-free. You don't even have to write it off, right? If they ask, you got to show them some medical expenses. I'll take questions at the end on this. Sorry about that. I just want to get to a few other things here. Everybody's buying this. You saw this example from Chris and Brent, right? So if you're in the 35% tax bracket and you're in the grocery store and let's say you spend $300 a month, you got to make $382 based on your tax bracket at $35,000. If you're at $70,000, you got to make $409 to get that $300. And if you're at $178,000, you got to make $462 to buy that same $300 worth of groceries because of taxes. Right, and then this is the same thing for the year. Think about it. If you know what your housing costs are, it's the same thing. This is the bite of taxes, right? And we can go through that, but I'm not going to do it. Now, the other thing I want you to do is think about your rate of return, right? Over here, 5% in your IRA. Let's look at 30 years just as an example. If you put $100,000 in there at 30 years, what is that? In the taxable account, you'd have $280,000, and in the IRA, you'd have $432,000. Big difference, right? Significant for the same exact investments, just the tax bites, right? And then let's go over here to for 30 years. That same $100,000 at 15% is worth $2 million there and $6 million here. Is that significant difference in your life? Right? So I need for you guys to think about this and figure out how to get it into your life. These are tools that they put out there. Nobody reads publication 590 or 560 or any of the IRS publications unless they can't afford Ambien. Right? So think about that where you are. And somebody says, well, you can only put 6,000 in, but if you're making 15% on $6 million, how much is that? Right? 10% 600,000, right? That's $1.2 million you're making every year. Right? So we're on to the questions. Anybody have the questions? You did, right? Grab the mic, please.
I got a really important
question. Okay.
You make. How come you can't?
How come I can't what?
With all the money
can't
you
afford
make.
A wallet. So you have a rubber band holding your money together.
Actually, it's a hair band that my granddaughter gave me. They last longer than the rubber bands. That's good too. Go ahead. Turn that mic on, please. Oh. put new batteries in it. He's got a, Phil's got a mic over here. Watch out, world.
Yeah. I'm willing to talk to you now. Now that I know you're done. So the HSA, that operates just like a Roth?
It does.
Okay.
Except you can take money out of it right away if you have health plans.
Carl.
It's even better.
I thought it was only, it's only if you use it for medical expenses that it's not taxable. If I, at the end of 65, if at 65 I take it out for any other reason but medical expenses, I have to pay taxes on whatever I take out.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So, because it's kind of like a combination traditional and Roth.
Well, but if you're 65 and you've been paying all of your medical expenses, you know, till you were 65 and you kept those receipts, you can take out however much those receipts are, right? And that's for toothbrushes, eyeglasses, dental work. You know, they've got a big, long list of that stuff.
Make sure you save the receipts for all our toothbrushes.
What? Yeah, yeah. Look, well, there's a lot of things, you know. Depends, you'll be on soon.
This is it. I have a question.
Go ahead.
Okay. Let's say your employer is taking out $1,000, for instance, for HSA, that is allocated to pay for medical expenses every year. How do you factor this into this HSA plan that you're talking about?
All right. The question was how do you factor HSA contributions that your company is taking out and putting into it, right? Well, they're putting it into an HSA account for you. I don't know how much money they're putting into it for you. They can put up to either $3,400 or $7,000, depending on family, single, or and how old you are. But if they're doing that, you have an HSA account somewhere that you have a statement for. Now, you can take that money that they do that and roll it over to CAMA plan and then start using that money to buy real estate. Otherwise, you put it in that plan and you're making, I don't know, a tenth of a percent or a half a percent today, or maybe nothing. You have to look at that and kind of see where it is if it's with with your boss. We'll say it again. You can roll over a current HSA. Yes, that's your HSA.
I noticed you said the 401k can also be a self-directed IRA. How do we go about doing that?
401k?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can be used as a self-directed.
Yeah. Do you have your own company?
Yeah.
If you have your own company, you can...
No. I mean, I work a company currently.
You work for a company. Do you have any old ones?
No.
All right. What company do you work for?
It's Conduent.
A big company?
Yeah.
You can ask that company if they'll allow you to self-direct it, but it's a pain in the neck for you to do that. But call us up. I can't handle exactly what you have right here today.
I'm sorry. Or you could roll it over to another account, right, from an existing.
It depends on how your plan is, how long you've been there, how old you are, et cetera. You have to ask your HR department what those rules and regulations are.
If you're on Medicare and you have an HSA, can you set up an HSA for your supplemental and your deductible?
No. Once you're on Medicare, you're toast.
Okay. Is there a certain amount that I need to have, like, funds-wise to start an account with you guys in CAMA plan?
The answer is under 4,000 is probably not worth it for you.
Okay.
But the minimum I think you should try to get is 4,000. But some accounts can only be 3,400 if it's an HSA. Some of the ESAs can only put 2,000 into them.
Makes
Talk
sense.
To us and let us know what you're doing.
Okay, thank you.
But I don't want you to be doing something and then can't use it.
Right.
But here's the other thing: is we're not going to charge you anything until you do a deal, right? Except to open up the account.
Okay.
All right. And then we won't charge you if you're sitting in cash. What's your name?
Rebecca.
Rebecca says this is awesome. We're not going to charge you anything when you're just sitting in cash. We're the only company out there that does that. We don't want you rushing into deals. Okay, so get your account open. You'll get a notice from us every now and then, and it'll keep it fresh on your mind, right here.
Yeah. So I have two questions. Can you open a fresh account with you? If I don't have a IRA currently, but can I open up?
Yes, you can open one up. Go right online, to it and open it up.
Okay. Now, the second question is, can I open IRA as well as an HSA?
Yes.
If I have a high deductible medical.
Yep.
Okay, so I can take advantage of two.
You can take advantage of two, yes.
Cool. Right. Thank you.